Sound. We were discussing a little bit, and you said, "Yeah, I have that problem even in a slow tempo." When you play. So, when you say, "What do you feel that you would say that is the problem with the sound?"
Well, probably the security when grabbing the strings.
Yeah. So what I've seen from the way of, you know, looking from up close here is when you are attacking the string. Starts from further away from the string, so there's this space between initial sort of impulse and the moment the finger touches the string. So there's that gap where you have that intention of plucking. That, as you say, sometimes it will miss. Although it's not, you know, that's not the main issue. At least not in this one that I see that you are missing the string. But what it is, it creates a gap in that strength. That result in the sound being more shallow. In other words, the string vibrates on with less intensity. So the sound tends to sort of stay here rather than project.
Okay.
So what I want as a concept, I read an article somewhere, and it was actually Segovia that said, you know, the idea is touch and play, touch and play. So I mean, in a place like in a, you know, when you play the music, it would result in staccato because you would come with the next finger. But if you just engage the string first, that you sense, It's not just sort of like pressing and letting go. No, it's engaging it and holding it there, almost like if you want to shoot an arrow.
Okay.
You have a moment when you tense it and you hold it, and then there's just a moment of
preparation.
Yeah. Or in other words, let's say that, you know, the finger is the ultimate plot. It's just one moment of when the finger is like a trigger to release the energy that's there, that it's stored. Okay? And another thing, what I'm seeing now is, as you're plucking, I think your nails might be a little bit too long, but when you're plucking, you release. I mean, when I ask you, engage the string, sort of like inside or diagonally, right? Not outwards, but inside.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you are plucking, you tend to go like this. You tend to release it this way. And I don't want that to happen, because then it's, again, like if you're holding the arrow, it's almost like you're letting it go here.
Okay.
So that, you're releasing part of the tension, so it won't go as far. So what I'm doing is, so that the finger goes inside, yes. So, because, yeah, that's where you are directing your strength. That's exactly it.
I'm feeling that I'm fighting between this movement and this.
Yeah. Do this for me. See, that's natural.
Yeah.
That's what we want to go. Now do this, like if you want to go upwards.
I feel tension here.
Yeah.
And when I'm playing, I feel somehow.
You feel that tension. So the whole concept of playing has to, the plucking the string has to change completely towards this.
Okay.
Because this is neutral, and you go in, and so the flexors pull the muscles in, and the extensors bring them out. But don't pluck the string with the extensors, don't pluck them out.
But then you say that I have like a bit long nails.
Yeah, I think so.
That's why also maybe I'm...
Yeah. In order to avoid this hook, okay. You are feeling now, you are giving away, and you are
letting them. And all of them, right? Or?
Yes, all of them. And also, for example, look at the way they are shaped. Play me with the eye finger. With eye finger, I don't think it will be that much of a problem, exactly, because the angle is shaped differently.
Yes.
You see? Because the string, there is no resistance here, it will slide off. But with these two, yes, because their angle is different.
Yeah. I'm just have this angle because of this sound. I kind of like it, yeah. And I have been trying with like any guitar player, like many angles and blah. But then is the problem with my when I really pull this.
Later on, we can talk a little bit more about shape and also the you know, maybe reinforcing the nails, because I use some silk to do it. But
okay.
Once again, let's go to, for example, put me these four fingers with the thumb on the fifth. So like that, you will have more space. I don't want it on the fourth, because when you play, bring it to the fourth, you know, it stands in the way. So just the eye finger and... Yeah. No, but it's not this. You see, listen very carefully. There's this, the moment right up, or there's this. You understand? So I'm tensing it. I will never employ this in performing.
Okay.
But I'm training. The maximum I can get... of noticing how you engage the string. Yes, so engage and then let go. There. And another thing, I see now a little bit of a tension there, is that almost the whole hand is engaged. Try now with A finger, that one definitely will go too long. See?
Okay.
Yeah. You know, engage the string. That's it. You get it's a different sound. It's a little bit too long the nail.
No, I'm playing with this angle, but usually I play more like this. So, I don't know. And then
but it's thinner.
Yeah, exactly.
And I don't mind, I don't mind so much the angles. I think, you know, you can in terms of what you do here,
yeah.
You know, whether it is for tremolo or different sort of combinations, you know, when I play something slow, my angle here, right? And I'm seeking for that sound, for that lush. If I go, it's different. It's asking for a little bit more of, you know, different kind of pronunciation.
Yeah.
Where this is, I really want to get the most out of the
okay.
instrument. Okay.
Good.
So that's. You know, towards the end, we can also try to, if you want, we can try to reshape the nail and do something about it.
That's awesome.
Yeah? Okay. Then let's start once again from beginning. Now on the musical side, what I'm seeing with this piece, few things that I would like to point out. One thing is that it has a tendency to be shaped very much with its this sort of like a motive like shape that it has from the beginning, which means, and then you stop with a nice decrescendo and even a little pause there. But what happens then, what I have problem with that is that imagine a story when you are telling, and that each of these measure is a word. Then it sounds a little bit like this. Mm. And the story does not have direction. Mm. You want me to keep going. So in that way, in another way, I also want to sense that you have a sense that there is a whole story and that there are chapters. In other words, there's parts, right? Like that you see, I go from this point to that point, I develop it, then the next one is going to be a little bit more developed or less or something like that, right? So to have those, and I'm sure that you already know where those points are, right? We have one, we have another one there, right? All those parts, and so on. So it's pretty clear where those shapes are. But what I want to get, instead of this development that it goes like this, I want to get that.
Like for...
So there are, it can be chords and phrases and dynamics. So that there are certain points that you get, you know, if you go from 1 to 3 to 2 to 5 to 4 to 6. You understand? So you're going crescendo, decrescendo, but overall you will have a bigger line. Okay? So, starting once again from the beginning. Because later on you have a lot to give. Think of this more like a choir piece,
okay?
Like choir singing, you know, that it's not so jumpy or dancy, but more of you are thinking of the sound. Let's do it together a little bit, just for me to impose my idea. You shape it, but don't stop. But not on every measure. Huh?
Okay. Yeah.
Let's go on there.
I like it more.
Now bring it down. Keep it more. Didn't catch you. It's there. Keep playing. Yeah. So I want to hear more of this dominant here. Okay. More playing for again from the seventh chord. Longer there, because I want to feel this climb there, this tease, this going on, you know, you could reach the top of the hill and then it will come down. Okay. Give me this. Sound. Never this. All the energy
like this,
directed right. Inside, almost like you're playing towards your stomach. keep it very legato and bring it down. And again, imagine that you're singing that voice there, keep it going down there, drive it, bring it down. Now this boy. Keep it there. Again, you have reached, but don't then. The next line has to come out of it. What you were playing, you came here, and then this was like something else.
Okay.
It has to have almost like you have a little fermata there, but it's a part of the same thing, and it goes on.
Okay.
So playing once again from here. The next one also, because they are all 60 notes apart.
You do this.
Yeah, I'm just as a consideration, I do this. It's a little bit lighter. Huh? I don't know what is it, but I think technically it's more difficult, and there's a little pause between the E and A. Ta ta ra ra, yeah, it feels a little bit like that. But where this. I have no problem if you want to use apoyando there. Just bring out. No accent on the bass. The voicing when you are giving these accents, it's a little bit too much. You have to do them with a sort of a slight gesture of timing, but not so much with the dynamic. From the bass, give me bass. Relax. Drive down, crescendo. Another thing, why I ask you this about the tempo, I mean, there is no indication what the tempo should be, right? So it could be arbitrary to decide, you know, how slow or how fast we can play. There's no right or wrong. Why I'm advocating for a little slower tempo, it's because it gives you time to bring this music with this feeling of fullness of the sound. Of development of the harmonies that you can hang onto those chords and onto those leading harmonies, dominance and resolution, just to give yourself a little bit more time, because in the other two movements you won't have it as much. Fugue is going to be a little bit faster and allegro even more. So this, you know, in terms of contrast, what I want to even emotionally convey with this piece is sort of this sense of reverence. It's almost like the sky opens up with a light when it, you know, explodes, and your whole soul feels in awe. Mm-hmm. I'm not religious, or not, you know, it's not that he was, right?
And literally, but they talk about the Trinity, and
but in a reverence to something. Yeah. Somebody can call it God, life, whatever, energy, yeah, right? But that you have this, like, just as you play, astonishment, I'm alive. But you know, then it turns, so you're asking yourself a question, moving along those things, then again it's major, right? And then there's more sadness there in the minor and things like that. So you give yourself space to involve all those things.
Okay.
So play me once again. We will just do a little bit of that. So I want to sense that before even you play, I want you to put yourself emotionally in that state, in that world of. In a sense, so it's not that you begin with the music. You begin before you start playing. Feeling.
From the beginning?
From the beginning, yeah. Don't push the tempo. No accents on the bass. Crescendo. Very nice. Now, just one more little thing is I would really avoid these slurs.
Okay.
Because they are bringing the element of when they are slow, it's a different sound.
Okay.
It's very different. In allegro, in a fugue, yeah.
Okay.
In a faster place. You know, if you. In tempo allegro. It would work.
Okay.
But in a slower tempo.
Even in terms of articulation, not either. Like the.
I don't think. Slow. You see, articulation. I mean, if we think of articulation, you can play on the two different strings and you will get more of that
legato,
right? To me, the problem is more that it is so slow.
Okay.
That when you do, the quality of sound,
okay,
it's sort of smeared with the noise of pull-offs.
Yeah, you know.
Since you can do it, I would rather say no.
Okay.
So let's go to the future. Tempo and then even more.
Okay, yeah.
So when you begin very fast. Fine, but then when you came here.
Yeah.
And then it settled to that tempo. You know, and why is it more or less we all end up when we play this in that tempo? There is something about this tempo lending itself naturally to this sort of shape or these appoggiaturas and so on. So be careful not to begin too fast.
Okay.
Another thing, So I'm breaking it out just in these two sections. So also, like when we are finishing, bring it out from nothing. An incredible stillness. You have plenty of time to develop both dynamically and emotionally, very horizontal. Part, sorry, not this one, then the subject comes again. But when you have this section, when you have these appoggiaturas, also, if we don't do something with it to have a sense of longer line, they all. No, what I'm saying is there has to be a sense of a longer line. Mm. Not that you just feel pam pa ram. But there's this crescendo, progression that not only how do you say, sound-wise crescendo, but emotional, because there's that tease, there's this build-up, there's this, you know, huge tension and build-up until the subject comes again, almost like a release. So let's leave once again from beginning. What I want you to do in the very beginning, as I said, again, imagine a choir. Imagine one voice beginning. And it's all even, and another one will join, and another one, and then, you know, it will expand. But there is not excitement in the beginning. Okay. It's a very long piece to give it too much excitement in the beginning. Together, ready, here. Very still, don't move at all. Meditate through it. Keeping the tempo. The voicing, it's not the same.
Here?
Yeah, change it. Yeah, sacrifice the bass. Just go down and keep the thirds as they are on the first and second. When you.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but in shifts like this, I'll show you something technically speaking. Okay, now as you shift down, don't leave with your elbow.
No.
No, okay. Don't, because it will throw you off the position.
That's true. And things.
Yeah. Keep the elbow in, and then adjust. That's
okay.
Yeah. Wait. Yeah, because then you are having a little bit more.
Yeah.
Same sound, right? Because this is very tricky that you will get here.
Yeah. Yeah, because of the A.
Because of open E.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so let's keep that one on a trick player.
Okay.
No, you second finger there. Regardless of the difficulty, this is cadenza, so it has to have the power there. Then you can, so, you know, so that how do you say, the impact, both dynamic and emotional, is huge. It's an unbelievable piece of music.
Yeah.
If we don't do it, we are not serving it well.
Yes.
Right? Okay, so let's take it once again from there.
This is okay.
Give me the score.
Okay.
Difficulty there.
I think the third finger for me, but then I try to put this elbow up.
Okay, let's do the other way around. Place the third finger down on that bass.
The octave?
Yeah. Right there. Just put it there. Yeah, but not like that. I want you to do it. So why is it difficult? Because if you are paying attention to these fingers here and you're adjusting the hand, bringing it down low to do this one, look, I can't reach it. That is difficult. So what has to happen is that the palm goes up. So this finger collapses as much as possible. So this whole mechanism goes up.
Okay.
And then it's not a problem. This is a problem. Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Right? Yeah, so you're bringing this as high as you can. So the fingers need to learn to be flexible, to collapse and to expand.
Yes.
Right? Without, you know, so you hand, you need to move everything. The more flexible you are in every, you know, from one little joint to the whole arm and the body, the more ability you have.
Yeah.
So give me that chord again. You see? That's it. Now, you are taking away by you are leaning towards the chord. Your whole body is losing the balance,
yeah.
And it loses the support for the right arm. That's why the chord sounds like this,
okay.
Not like this. So now, as I told you, feel this. That's it. Feel the whole body connected in here. So the same that your body can give you, if you press your chest against the guitar and use this arm to secure a little bit more the chord in one moment, the same thing here. And you said this mechanism becomes not away, inside. You are doing this. And I want this. You understand what I mean? Look. I want this. I don't want that.
Maybe there's no without it. Yeah, then it looks, so now it's cooking.
Doesn't matter. Now it's cooking, but that's exactly the intensity I want. Yes. Okay. More. Elevate the wrist, right hand wrist. Yeah. Feel it?
Yes.
There we are. That's what I want. That's what I want. Yeah, the moment I drop my wrist. Different sound.
Okay.
Okay, so let's go on. Then it drops and then you develop from there. Play. Yeah, then again we have that. What do you do? you're doing the slur. Yes. Maybe without the slur. Let me see how it sounds. Much better. Yeah. It's not that fast for fingers not to be able to do it. When you come from here, I want to see that transition.
Okay.
No. Directly there. And then, so this I'm stopping because of the technical difficulty.
Okay.
There's difficulty in shifting. Why?
Again, the third?
No, you're reaching that with the second, actually. No, you are playing that with the second. Yeah, I'll tell you what is the problem. The problem is that you're blocking all the fingers within the chord when you are doing the shift. In other words, when you play this, you are here by the time you play the last note. And then you jump to this.
Yeah.
What I'm saying...
Okay. Release before.
Very slow. And then the first one as well. And there you are. Now you have your legato. So this is a sequential resolution of legato, okay, of the problem. Not to think I'm in this position and then I'm in this position. For most of the time it works.
Yeah.
But very, very often, especially in this music, it will cause the trouble.
Yeah.
So you have to very sort of how do you say, intellectually or analytically solve this problem to understand what's happening. Where do my fingers have to do to go? What do I need? What I don't need? What can I sacrifice? Where? What's the main voice that needs to stay? What, you know? What's my objective?
Yeah.
Because if you have a bass that no problem whatsoever, but if you cut that on the top line, legato, yes.
Okay,
let's go on from there. Keep it almost again like a one horizontal voice that's singing. Yeah, but that has to grow, that has to, that's what I'm saying. Don't, when you come to this, don't drop it in dynamics within the four notes.
Okay.
Because it gives, for us, it's all about creating these dynamic illusions. So since this voice cannot be crescendoed, it's either like this or drops down. It's the rest of the notes that in the accompaniment.
Do you suggest also the subject going up the dynamic or all the harmonies?
Everything now. I would say everything. It needs that build up. Okay. Play along with me, right there. Another thing, I don't want you to be comfortable. Here's another thing that I want you to show you technically. When you have a bar across four strings, collapse the first finger. What it does, it brings these close by.
Okay.
If you have this, fingertips are far away, and super far, such incredible strain on the fingers. Somewhere in between, that's it. And then the stretch, exactly, yes. Okay. Nah, but don't you tick-tack. Yeah, because that's such a nice... Here... We want that... That's it. That's what we can do. We can create that legato.
My... afraid is just like, I don't want to jump this string to the first. But...
Yeah, stretch.
Yeah.
You need some time, but you will work it out.
Okay.
No slur.
No what slur?
Slur.
No slur.
I would. And then fingering there, you should change on the last note. So from here, two on the last one, so that you can execute the shift easier. Yeah, because again, we are going ta-ri-da-ti-da-ri-da-ti-da-ri-da.
Okay.
Otherwise, you get that cut there, if you play that with, sorry.
Yeah, the shift.
Yeah. Two. Even if the lower voice is... It's made into eighth notes, yeah, exactly. So play me this.
Yes. And the smaller bass then.
Yeah. Okay. And lift the other. Lift the other fingers.
Other.
So you get a shape. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Like that, you get. Otherwise, you can't get the connection.
Yes.
Lift in that moment. Ta di da, and you lift 3-4. Have to squeeze them in.
Okay.
And yeah. So, okay, you'll fix that. That's it. I wrote it. Third finger.
Yeah.
Then. Yeah. If we give so much time on each of those, it has to move along a little bit better. Now another thing here. Use the indicated fingering, open, shift over, open, second. Again, look, here you have an open string. This is, you know, we go back between the music and the technique. Mm-hmm. You have open strings that you need absolutely use them in order to shift the left hand position. You can't play E and stay there.
Okay.
Open. Third.
Okay.
Third. Yeah. And then you have 1, 2.
Yeah.
So every time you have an open string to shift the position, and suddenly the things are.
Yes.
Easy. Yeah. Yes. Let's go on.
Sorry.
Let's go on from there.
Be minor.
Second finger on B, because you ended up with the first finger on E. Yes. There. Second finger, because first is on E.
And then you shift up.
Yeah, up, yeah, exactly. Second, first. 1, 1, 1, 1. Then. There I see that the left hand is suffering quite a bit, and it's because it's playing from this position. Again, it has to come out into curve. Maybe this.
play super different.
So then why? Because there's one fingering indicated around. He's doing this and I'm doing this. No, I do not know how you are playing it, so let's go back to muscle memory. Go back from there.
Can we change the bass?
No, be natural. No. You need to play this with the fourth finger. Again. Your shifts are not easy. This is okay, because it's 3-3. Up everything in the last note.
Ah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Always using the last note as a bridge that connects. This is open. Here,